Hello, hello, hello. Today is Wednesday, August 21st, 2024. Here follow the solutions to problem 209. There were 40 correct solutions. But many of these 40 first had the wrong solution. And this time I decided in all cases to write to you, your answer is wrong. And that helped. Many of you then did their homework on what the physical pendulum is about, and then they got it right. To approximate the sphere at the end of the pendulum to be a point source is a blunder, because that's not the case for physical pendulums. They take the size into account. The size comes up with the moment of inertia. It's true that in your final answer, the mass does not show up. The mass of that sphere doesn't show up, but the size does. I cover physical pendulums in great detail with many demonstrations in lecture 21 of 801. If you're ready for Keith Norman's video for his straightforward solutions following exactly the approach of my lecture 21. As usual, his solutions are great. If you're ready, I am ready.
This is Keith's solution to Walter Lewin's problem 209, and it concerns a solid sphere attached to a pivot point by a massless string, so it can act as a pendulum. I'll swing backwards and forwards, fully covered in his 801 lectures. There is a playlist for each of his series of lectures with informative titles, so do a bit of searching and you will find what you need to know to solve this problem. I would suggest that even though you might be able to dip in and find 5 minutes here or 5 minutes there, that you will get far, far, far more out of his lectures if you watch entire lectures. There is a depth of knowledge there. I know he does lots of nice demonstrations, but when you put the lecture together, when you put it all together, you will acquire a depth of knowledge that I don't think you'll get simply by saying, I want to find the answer to such and such. So do try and look at entire lectures. Anyway, back to the problem. Solid sphere, radius r, mass m, acting as a pendulum attached with a massless string. For the sphere, the moment of inertia about its own centre of mass, we can either look up or calculate if you feel like it. It's this value here. So apply the parallel axis theorem about this point. We get the moment of inertia of our system, which is this mass, this sphere, is going to be this here. Straightforward parallel axis theorem. We can then use tor equals I alpha, which is the angular equivalent of F equals ma, about here, where we need to know the restoring force, about P, which is going to be minus mg sine theta L plus R. Well, mg sine theta is going to be this perpendicular component of the force, this direction there, and clearly L plus R is that, so we get that's the torque. And it's minus because it's opposing the positive direction of theta. That equals IP, which we found down here previously, times theta double dot. hopefully you're familiar with that notation. It's the second time derivative of theta. So theta double dot is our alpha there. Okay, put all that together with small angle approximation, we get this. Now, you should recognize anything of this form, we can reduce it to that, and that should scream wave equation, oscillations, resonance, all manner of things to do with periodic solutions, so sine and cos solutions, because we know that omega squared is positive, IP is going to be positive, M, G, L, R, L plus R will be positive. So we know this is true. So we're looking for the periodic solution. Omega now, omega squared, we get to be this, simply substituting for IP, this value in this expression. I can simplify that a bit to this, which is quite a nice way of leaving it. If I look here, I can see that if I let R tend to zero, then I will actually get fives will cancel out, the R's of course become zero, and I will get omega equals root G over L, which is what I would expect for a point mass, but for our situation R is not zero, so we get that. Or you might well have simplified it further to this here, where I've just expanded out the brackets and combined terms. That is my solution. Thank you.